Okay. Good evening, everyone, or good morning if you are in the US. It's a pleasure for me to welcome you to the eAccess Forum on Climate Change, Macroeconomics and Finance. I would like to remind you that this forum is here to facilitate the exchange of ideas around climate change, macroeconomic finance, and then also policy proposals. I also would like to invite you to join the eAccess Forum on Slack. It's a workspace, it's a community of researchers, regulators, and central bankers working on the issue of climate change and the environment. And in these Slack channels, you will find a curated and comprehensive list of working paper news and conferences information about this issue. And you can join this Slack line with the link posted in the chat. That being said, it's my pleasure to welcome Laurent Clerc to this meeting. Laurent is a director for research and risk analysis at the Autorité de Contrôle Prudentiel et de Résolution, ACPR, the French supervisor of banks and insurance companies. And previously, he held various positions at the Banque de France, notably as director of financial stability, and he played a very important role in the inception of the NGFS. Laurent has been working since a long time on the nexus of climate change and financial stability and central banks. I was one of the first to give conferences and sharing these ideas on this issue. It's really a great pleasure to have him here. Let me say that he was also director for monetary and financial studies. And he also worked as an economist at the Bank of England, the ECB, the OECD, and the French Economics and Finance Ministry. Today, Laurent will present the work that the French authorities have done regarding a climate pilot exercise. But before I give the floor to Laurent, I would like to introduce something new in this series. We have some question prepared for you that you could answer directly on your screen if it works. And this would give us, you can just tell quickly what you think, and this would give us a basis to discuss this issue with Laurent. So I let you answer that quickly and I will comment the results. And the idea for you to know is to ask you the same question after this seminar to see if Laurent's argumentation has changed something in your mind. So if everybody responded, I think we can start with Laurent and your presentation. The floor is yours.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Pierre, for your invitation to present the work that we are currently conducting at the ACPR on the climate stress test. So if you can move to the next slide, please. And the next one. Okay, so today I will then present what we are currently doing. So what are the main objectives and features of the climate pilot exercise. Then I will move to a presentation of the main scenarios and the way we selected them. Then I will go into the details of the analytical framework that we developed for transition risk and present some result. By result, I mean the assumptions that were generated in order to conduct this stress test exercise. And I will complete my presentation by some complements on physical risk. So if we can move to next slide, please. Before I start, if you are interested in, what I'm going to present is based on two publications. The first one is the document that presents the climate pilot exercise, so the scenarios. It's on the ACPR website. And accompanying this publication, you will find also a set of Excel files presenting all the material that has been provided to French bank and insurance companies in order to run the exercise. And the second one is the working paper presenting the analytical framework that we use today, and that was especially developed for transition risk. So next slide, please. So let me first start with the main objective. So this work has in particular been was started a few years ago. The ACPR in fact started to work on climate change issues in 2015 in the context of the preparation and the enforcement of a French law on energy transition and green growth. This French law introduced further requirements in terms of disclosure for listed companies, institutional investors, and as far as banks are concerned, it also asks the supervisor to run regular stress tests. So in this context, we started to work on the exposure of the banking and insurance sector to climate change risk. And we made two publications in early 2019. And based on this publication, we set up two working groups with the industry. One on the governance of climate change risk, and we published our best practices last May, and this is also available on the ACPR website. And the second work stream was based on scenario analysis, and the idea was really to prepare this first climate pilot exercise. So in terms of objective, they are quite standard for a prudential authority. So the first objective is to size the risk and the vulnerabilities. The starting point of supervisors and of the ACPR in particular is that climate change risk is still mispriced by financial players and in particular financial markets. So there is a risk of abrupt adjustment. And the second objective is perhaps also as important as the first one, is a methodological objective. The idea is to work with the industry in order to develop appropriate model and stress test methodologies, but also to identify data gaps. And that is all the impediment that that limits so far the ability of the financial sector to factoring this kind of risk. As far as the industry is concerned, the participants of the working group have several objectives. The first one was really to better understand the transmission channel of climate change risk for their activities. The second, which is also important, was to work on a common set of assumptions. And one aspect of importance for the industry was comparability of the result across firms. So what we have seen in particular is that several firms have developed their own methodologies, but there is a lot of heterogeneity in terms of practices in the industry. And this exercise, in a way, is the first attempt to try to coordinate a bit and to set a common set of assumptions so that you can, in the end, compare the result. The industry also expressed a strong preference, and this is related to the first point of better understanding the transmission channel, a strong preference to have an exercise which is based on consistent scenarios, therefore articulating climate change with macro and financial developments, rather than relying on ad hoc shocks, which has been so far the usual practice of supervisors. And the last issue that was important, and I will come back to that, was also to set an appropriate time horizon. So in their current practices and their own exercises, firms usually rely on a very short horizon, 3 to 5 years at the maximum, whereas we need to work at longer horizon, and therefore we need to find also to strike the right balance between what we would like to do in order to measure climate change risk and what we are able to do. So this is the trade-off that we are facing, both supervisors and the industry. If we can move to next slide. I think there is a slide before. Yes. Oh no, okay, so this one. Okay, so this table provides you with a comparison of what is required for standard stress test exercises and what we need for climate change scenarios. So I will highlight just several features of that. The first is quite obvious when you're looking and dealing with climate change risk. It's the time horizon, because you need a long time horizon in order to factor in both transition and physical risk. So typically, as I said before, standard exercises rely on a short-term horizon, 3 years in general for central bank exercises, whereas here we need longer, much longer horizon. So in what I'm going to present, the horizon is 30 years. Another key important aspect is related to scenario drivers. A key challenge in order to carry out this kind of exercise is to use climate policy or climate and environmental data. And banks typically, and some insurance companies as well, are not used to work with this kind of data. And their risk model do not factor in this kind of data. So in what I'm going to present today, a huge effort has been made by the ACPR and the Banque de France to translate these environmental, physical, climate data into meaningful data for banks and insurance companies, that is macrofinancial data, which are typically used in standard stress test exercises. A key aspect with respect to climate risk is that initially, internal models are calibrated from historical data, whereas in the context of climate change, we do not necessarily have enough data to calibrate the model. And this is why also we have developed scenarios to overcome this lack of data. An additional feature of climate change is that it will affect sectors and geographies in a very heterogeneous manner, so that we, compared to standard stress tests, you need to develop a framework where you take into account more granular sectoral approaches and also more granular geographical exposures. And that's a key aspect. And I think I can move to the next slide, please. So in this slide, you have the, as a summary, the main features of the exercise, and this is something on which I will come back later on. So the pilot exercise is currently running and was launched last July. As I said, it's a 30-year horizon exercise, so it covers the period running from 2020 to 2050. As a key features, I think it's the first bottom-up exercise which is carried out by the industry. By bottom-up, I mean that the set of assumptions is provided by the ACPR and the Banque de France, but the computation and the risk measurement is carried out by firm using their own models. And that is very important in order to incentivize these firms to develop their models and to take into account climate change. And it is also a voluntary exercise, since we have been working in the context of working group. In terms of representativeness, however, we cover at least 85% of the banking sector. There are 10 major banks participating into the exercise. And we have also 13 insurance companies or groups participating in this exercise. And this is also approximately 85% of the business, of the insurance business in France. This exercise has no implication in terms of capital requirements. It's the first time we do this exercise. And one key aspect, and I will come back to that, is that we allow firms to take management actions and therefore to dampen the impact of climate change on their solvency. Due to the fact that in France we have major international players, both in the banking side and in the insurance side, our exercise factoring the international dimension. So what we have done here is that we have taken into account exposures in France, in Europe, excluding France, in the United States, and the rest of the world. By the rest of the world, we also factor in material exposition. For instance, if a firm or a bank, for instance, is exposed to a major counterparty located, for instance, in Russia. So that will be the exposure that we will take into account. So the objective here is to cover something between 80 and 85% of the exposure of both banks and insurance companies in terms of geographical coverage. There is also a granular sectoral approach. So in this exercise, we consider 55 business sectors. The decomposition is based on a database, which is the World Input Output Database. And this is very important to rely on this kind of input output database because it helps you to work also on the value chain and take into account both the input and the output of each sector. So this decomposition is provided in this exercise for each of the scenario and each of the geographical areas I just mentioned. Another important aspect of this exercise is that it covers both banks and insurance companies. And what we are interested in particular is the interplay between those two sectors and the systemic dimension of system to that risk. Transition is impacting all sectors, in particular bank and insurance companies, while physical risk directly impact the insurance sector and impact also indirectly the banking sector. An additional very important assumption and feature of this exercise is that we are combining both the static and dynamic balance sheet assumptions. Static means that banks and insurance companies do not have the ability to change the structure of their balance sheet until 2025. And from that date until the end of the exercise, they can use the dynamic balance sheet assumption, meaning that they can implement management action in order to both reduce their exposure vis-à-vis climate change risk and also take into account the benefits, which may be, and the opportunities, which may also arise from climate change. Because of this dynamic balance sheet assumptions, it imposes further constraint for us. In particular, we need to assess the consistency of the individual response of each participant in the exercise. So that's the first step. The idea is to make sure that when you aggregate individual responses, it still makes sense at the aggregate point of view with respect both to the structures of the economy to finance and to ensure. And we need also, and we use also this exercise to perform a second round and to compute second round effects. By second round, I mean the fact that banks initially, at least in our experience, do not consider that they are directly exposed to physical risk. They consider that this is the job of insurers. But in fact, due to the increase of both the cost and frequency of climate change risk, insurance policies will change, and it is likely also to impact on some of the risk parameters of banks. And this is something that we will assess in the context of sensitivity analysis in order to take that into account. The idea is really here to help the industry to think about the systemic dimension of climate change risk. If we can move to next slide, please. So now I'm going to the second part of my presentation, which is dealing with scenario selection and presentation. So as I said, we, in order to develop these scenarios, we worked with the industry. One important component of this industry was their desire also to factor in as a reference scenario the national strategy, which is referring to a transition to a low carbon economy. So this is something that we have factored in. And in order to develop the scenarios, we have also worked extensively with academia in the context of workshops and conferences. And we also relied a lot on the work carried out by the NGFS. So the NGFS is the network developed by central bank and supervisors. NGFS stands for Network for Greening the Financial System. And as you may be aware of, the NGFS published in July or at the end of June this year, a set of high-level scenarios. And some of these high-level scenarios have been factored in our exercise. So if you can move to the next slide. So in our exercise, we rely on four scenarios. There are three scenarios which are dealing with transition risk and one which is dealing with physical risk. So as far as the three transition risk scenarios, there is one baseline and two adverse scenarios. And the shocks which are taken into account are driven by two variables. The first is carbon prices, which are increased through the implementation of carbon tax policies. And the other driver is productivity, which is helping the economy and facilitating the transition to a low carbon economy. And the adverse scenario in this exercise depend on the timing of the shock, so whether you act too little or too late, the size of the shock, so that is the too little part. And there are also some assumptions with respect to the fact that you are able to develop new technologies that will help reducing carbon emission or not, and that is factored in through a negative productivity shock. As far as the physical risk scenario is concerned, we just rely on RCP 8.5. So RCP stands for a pathway which is the most challenging and the most favorable and pessimistic scenario in terms of climate change developed by the International Panel on Climate Change. If we can move to next slide. So here you have a schematic representation of the scenarios. So as I said, so in green, you have the baseline scenario, which is based on one of the high level scenario. It is featuring an orderly transition by which we will be able to reach the objective set by the French national strategy of a transition to a low carbon economy. This objective is net zero emission at the horizon of 2050. So it is an orderly transition to the extent that all the countries which have signed the Paris Agreement are respecting this agreement. And it assumes also that there are productivity or innovation which are facilitating this transition. And then we have added two adverse scenarios. The first is also based on the NGFS high-level scenarios. It is called delayed transition, and in this chart it is represented in yellow. Delayed transition means that authorities take actions, but very late. So in the context of this exercise, it's only in 2030. And they increase the carbon tax by a huge amount in order to reach the objective of net zero of zero net emission by the horizon of 2050. Since those two scenarios in terms of macroeconomic and financial development were not very different one to the each other, we added a third scenario, which is called variant two or sudden transition. So this is the red scenario. In this scenario, the idea was to introduce a more important shock, which is featuring which is combining two shocks. The first is an additional and more abrupt change in carbon prices, and the second is related to less favorable productivity development. The last scenario is the one which is used to back physical risk. So it is based on a no transition scenario, meaning that in this scenario, government do not take any further action. And this is the business as usual scenario. And this is based, as I said, on the most pessimistic scenario in terms of climate change that is currently available. So if we can move to next slide. So in terms of scenarios, so here you have, for instance, the shocks represented by carbon prices in the three transition scenarios. And as you can see, the changes can be dramatic, especially in the most abrupt scenario, where we moved from a carbon price at the international level of $14 currently, up to more than $900 and something around $920 at the horizon of 2050. And so in terms of calibration, so what we have used, and I will be more specific after that, is also a combination of carbon price shock and productivity shock. And so in the sudden transition scenarios, we assume that there is no change in productivity, that is, there is no positive productivity shock with respect to the baseline. So this is something which is more pessimistic from this point of view. So if we can move to next slide. So now I'm moving to the third part. So I will present the analytical framework that has been developed especially for this exercise, and which is tackling transition risk. So here the idea is really to move from high level scenarios provided by the NGFS, but also variables, especially climate change variable, which are usually expressed in terms of physical variables like emissions, CO2 per tons of productions, wind speed, etc., sea level, for instance. So these are the kind of variables that typically do not enter into a typical internal bank model. And for the insurance sector, it is the same for those insurance companies which do not hold or do not have a catastrophe model, for instance. So in this case, they are not used to work with these variables. So what we did in the context of this exercise is to develop a complete framework that help us to, say, translate this climate change variable into standard macro financial variable, which are typically used by banks and insurance companies in the context of regular stress test. So the starting point of this approach, and as you see, there is a cascade of different models. So the starting point is to work with an integrated assessment model, which has been in fact used in particular by the IPCC, and the NGFS also worked with some of the climate change or the climate institute that are usually providing this scenario in the context of the IPCC reports. So from there and from the NGFS publication, you get very high level reference scenarios. So by high level scenarios, I mean that you have a limited set of output variable. Typically you get carbon prices, GDP, greenhouse gas emission, but at a very high level. and very low level of disaggregation. So typically you have broad regions like Europe, the United States, Asia, for instance. So this is a disaggregation that is useless for institutions since you need to have more granular exposure. But the outcome of this model, in particular carbon prices and GDP, are used as input and enter into the second stage of the model. So here we use an international macroeconomic model. And the idea is that we calibrate this model by using, in particular, productivity shock to replicate these high-level scenarios and to decompose, therefore, these high-level variables into a set of macroeconomic variables for each region and as detailed as needed for the implementation of stress tests. So when I mean as detailed, so you have a breakdown of GDP into relevant aggregates like consumption, investment, but also unemployment, prices, deficit, public debt, etc., which are useful, and as well as inflation. These are typically the macroeconomic variables that are used in stress test exercises. Then we use a first step, so another model, which is a sectoral model. So in this model, we are disaggregating this macroeconomic variable into this 55 sector of activities. And so this is done for each scenario and each region. So I will present that. And then we have a block of models which are used and which we call financial models, which are used both to generate intrasectoral data, in particular at the firm level. So, and I will come back to that. And also financial modules by which we can generate a set of relevant asset prices and financial variables, which are very useful for both banks and insurance companies to assess their market risk. So in the context of this exercise, our focus is on credit risk, operational risk indirectly through physical risk, counterparty risk, and market risk. So if we can move to next slide. So here I will be fast because I will not go into the details, but I will present all the steps that we use. So as I said, we start from the NGFS reference scenarios and these climate scenarios made by the IPCC. And we use a macroeconomic model, which is the NIGEM model. It's a multi-country Newcastle general equilibrium model. And in this model, climate change and in particular carbon emissions are incorporated into the model through a carbon tax. And what you need just to know, and you can refer to the documentation if you want to have more information, is that by this way, there are three ways by which climate change can impact the economy. So productivity, as I said, because we calibrate the model in order to replicate the NGFS pathways. And then there are two canals by which carbon emission or carbon tax impact the macroeconomy. The first one is that it affects energy prices as intermediate cost. And here we assume that there is an international price of carbon. And aside of that, you have a carbon tax, which is set by country and which depends upon the level of emission. And so this will impact the relative cost of energy and therefore will affect the oil intensity of production. And the other impact stems through energy prices, which will increase in particular and will increase the relative cost of energy in the consumption basket, but also have an impact on consumer prices and consumer level. And this will in in addition, therefore impact more aggregate variable like GDP, consumption, wages, and unemployment. So next step, please. So in terms of impact, and these are the assumptions which are generated. So you can see here the impact on real GDP. So the figures are expressed in deviation from the baseline. So you have the two scenario transition with respect to the baseline scenario of an orderly transition. So as you can see, the more severe the scenario, the more you get an impact. The positive figures at the beginning of the period reflect the fact that during this time, there is no policy action. So no policy action means more favorable economic development. But as soon as you start to implement policies, you increase the cost of carbon, and therefore you have a negative impact on activity and a strong impact on inflation. And this explains the negative impact that you can see. So you can see that the impact can be huge, especially for rest of the world country or China, which are depending a lot on carbon, and rather limited, but still important and material impact for countries like France or Europe or the United States. And what you can see also is that there is a lot of heterogeneity across countries. And this is why it is important also to take into account international exposures of banks and insurance companies. Next slide, please. So you can also have additional breakdown. So I will not insist on that. So for instance, here you have the impact on inflation for France or also on deficit, but I will not insist for the sake of time. So if we can move to next slide. So then next slide is the sectoral model. So here, the idea is to break down GDP into 55 sectors of activities. And for that, we use a model which have been developed by two colleagues at the Banque de France, Antoine de Vulder and Noémie Lisac. So this is a general static real equilibrium model that is calibrated in a multi-country and multi-sector model. As I said, we have relied on the World Input Output Database to do that. And the important point is that this model allows for substitution, first across sectoral goods, energy and labor at the aggregate level, and then at the sectoral level between several types of energy, but also between different goods entering into the production sector. And in terms of energy types, we have introduced several kinds of energies. And in one version, we have also introduced renewable energies. So next slide, please. So in terms of sectoral impact, here again, what you can see is that there is a huge heterogeneity across sectors, with some sectors that will benefit from the transition because they are low carbon emission sectors, but others which will be heavily impacted, in particular in the energy, in mining, or in agriculture. So we can move to next slide. Then once we got the variable at the sectoral level, we can use another model in order to get infrasectoral data. So by infrasectoral data, I mean that we can get information and data regarding the probability of default of firms, in particular for French firms. So in this context, the outcome of this model, which is featured in this figure by the small letter S in the red color. So these are transformed into financial ratios for firms. And these financial ratios are factored in the internal rating model of the Banque de France to get a probability of default. So this model is based on the French National Central Credit Register. And in this model, we have more than 270,000 firms that we can use in order to produce these variables. So if you can move to next slide. So here you have, for instance, the dispersion of probability of default with respect to changes in value added. And as you can see here again, there is a huge heterogeneity across sectors, with default probabilities increasing a lot in sectors, for instance, petroleum or mining. Next slide, please. But we can move to next slide because it's the same. Then we have a set of financial modules which we use to compute a set of variables which are important. So the first set of variables which we need to develop in order to produce also relevant variable or corporate risk spread. So here we rely on a methodology that is based on the Risk Management Institute, and will provide us with additional data at the firm level. So it is based on a Bayesian VAR, VRR, vector autoregressive model, by which we are able to produce credit spread over a 5-year period based on economic sectors and scenarios that has been developed. And so we are able to compute this kind of credit spread for each scenario and each country. So if you can move to next slide. So next slide shows, for instance, the evolution of this credit spread with respect to several sectors. So here again, you can see that some of these sectors will be faced with a sharp increase in their credit spread with respect to the baseline. So next slide. So the next slide is another module that we have used to generate risk-free term structure. So it is based on a no arbitrage Gaussian affine macro finance term structure model. So the idea is that we need this variable first to generate risk-free term structures, because this is used in particular by insurance companies to discount their liabilities, and that is why we need this distribution. One important aspect is that these risk-free rates are also consistent with economic activity and inflation rate, which are generated by the scenarios that have been developed at the sectoral and macroeconomic level. So, and they will be used also to calibrate asset prices. So if we can move to next slide. So here you have an outcome of this risk-free weight. So you can see that at the longer horizon, because of in particular low activity, there will be a strong decrease in the risk-free rate with respect to the baseline scenario by almost 250 basis points. Next slide, please. So the next slide is the generation of stock prices. So here we rely on a standard dividend discount model. What is important to realize is that we rely on ad hoc assumption with respect to the distribution of dividend and the share of capital remuneration in the value added. But in order to compute asset prices, we compute a risk premium that is depending on the risk premia stemming from corporate spread risk. So if you can move to next slide. So next slide, you can see here the impact on asset prices of these different scenarios. And here again, you can see that, for instance, petroleum, agriculture, mining will be heavily impacted by climate change scenarios factored in our analysis, with sharp decrease, which can be as important as minus 50%, for instance, for petrol in the most severe scenario. So next slide, please. So with respect to physical risk, so as I said, we relied on the most severe scenario, which is RCP 8.5, and that is related to an increase of temperature ranging from 1.4 degrees Celsius to 2.6 degrees Celsius in 2050. So the idea is here to look at the exposure, the direct exposure of insurance companies and the indirect exposure of banks through the insurance sector. Here we have relied on two external bodies, the Caisse Centrale de Réassurance, which has worked on scenarios provided by Météo France, and AON, which has provided us with F scenarios related both with an increase in disease related to climate change and an increase also in health disease related to an increase in the temperature. So next slide. So next slide, so you can see that at the horizon of 2050, the different scenarios do not involve a lot of changes, but that's why we took the most severe scenario. And maybe we can move to next slide, and I'm about to finish.
Just,
so maybe yeah, I can just, move, yes, yes.
So I'm going to lose our that one. A few times.
Yes, so perhaps. So health risk, I just mentioned that. So there are two kinds of risk which are factored in. So pandemics and health pathologies, which are related to the deterioration of health quality. So this is also factored in this exercise. And I think, yes, the final slide is that one. So this is the schedule of the pilot exercise. So now we are in October. So we just received the first round of projection by French banks. So we did last week the consistency analysis. So yes, we looked at the projection made by banks on their credit exposures, and we end up with the conclusion that for most of them it was consistent with the scenarios. So there are just a couple of them for which we have required some changes. And the next round is December, by which firms will deliver their final result. Starting at the beginning of next year, we will take into account and factoring the second round effect. And we will publish the result by the end of perhaps April next year. And then we will start working on the methodology in the context of working group based on the outcome of this exercise. And I stop there. Sorry for being long.
Thank you very much. It was very interesting and detailed. And it shows how far we've progressed from the concept of climate stress testing a few years ago to the implementation of these stress tests. So you can ask questions in the Q&A section or by raising your hand. There are already some questions that came during your presentation. One by Luca Tashini regarding the step three of your presentation, and basically, can you elaborate on your result and tell us a bit about who are the losers and winners, and how this ranking changes depending on the way the impact and the channel are modeled? Does it always, are the results always coherent between scenarios, or does scenario has a large impact on finding who is a winner and losers?
Okay, you want me to react now?
Yeah, there is that. And I think maybe you can react on this question first, and then I'll try to summarize.
So as you can see, and it is also consistent with the other steps. So in general, what we observe is that there is a consistent impact in terms of the losers to some extent. And it is with no surprise the sectors which are responsible for carbon emission, because here you have two assumptions. And the more you you issue carbon, the more you will be taxed. So that will be very defavorable. And in addition, in order to facilitate transition, you need more investment and more productivity shock. So here, the more negative the scenario means also that you do not benefit from the positive aspect of technological change, and therefore you are not able to reduce your emissions. So in the end, across the board, you will see that petrol, mining, agriculture, sewage are the most impacted sectors. Whereas, for instance, in the case of France, so that is also very specific to each country. In the case of France, electricity, for instance, will be the sector that will benefit from these scenarios, because we rely on nuclear power and not carbon power. So that is very specific to France. If you would be in another country, you would obviously find a different hierarchy between different sectors.
You have, I see that Maria Nieto has raised his hand. So Maria, if you can just unmute you and maybe show your video to ask your question. If possible. If not, I have a question also. Maria, yeah, we can hear you.
Can you hear me now?
Yes, we can.
Yes.
Okay, thanks so much. Well, first of all, congratulations, Laurent. I read the report, but your presentation has been magnificent. I must say that it was very, very clear. As a matter of fact, I still don't have very clear this top-down versus bottom-up approach. I understand that what you have done in practice and what you have presented here, it has been a top-down approach. What you guys have done, and I'm not very clear what is the data that you have provided to the banks so that you will check consistency. And also I would like to know, where will you focus your attention in terms of assessing how consistent your results are with those from the banks? Thank you.
Okay, so perhaps to clarify. So by bottom up, what I mean is that here what we have done is only to provide firms with the set of variables, which are macro, economic, sectoral, and financial variables. And what we ask firms to do is to, like in said EBA stress test, to use this variable, which are the same for each banks and each insurance company, and to use their internal model or their model to assess the impact on their business activity. So on their, depending on, yes, their own portfolio, et cetera. So if you go on the ACPR website, you will find several Excel files where you have all the assumptions in terms of macroeconomic and financial variables. In the documentation, you have also assumptions with respect to health risk. So in terms of increase in morbidity, for instance, mortality or the level of people who are sick. And with respect to physical risk, it's a bit different here because we are working with Caisse Centrale de Réassurance, which is a reinsurer. And here, typically, insurance companies provide the CCR with their stake. So what are the stakes which are insured at the local level? So it's a very granular approach. And they are based on the projection made by Météo France, the CCR provide them with the impact on their on their exposure with respect to the materialization of four different kinds of physical risk. So that's why I call it a bottom-up exercise, to the extent that all the computation with respect to the risk is performed by the companies and not by us. It will be a full top-down exercise if we would be able to use this exercise to look at the impact on the banking system and the insurance sector. And so what we expect from this exercise, so it's not necessarily about the exposure, because based on the previous publication, we more or less know the extent to which they are exposed to climate change. But what we would like to really focus on are the methodological aspects. So what are the key challenges they are facing? Are their model really designed to take into account this kind of risk? What are the challenges made by the long horizon? Because they typically have a very short-term decision horizon, and the use of their model is conditioned to that. Also, in terms of data, so what are the data which are missing in order to carry out this kind of exercise? So that will be really the focus of the of this first exercise.
Thank you. We have one other question by Emanuele Campiglio, who is asking, so where do you see this modeling exercise going beyond 2022? And do you expect this exercise to become compulsory exercise with repercussion on capital requirement? And is that something that the ACPR can decide, or is it something that the government has to decide? The government has to decide in the case of France.
So now, for France, here the exercise is done for both banks and insurance. So as you know, in Europe, main banks are supervised by the ECB. So if there would be an exercise leading to capital requirements, this should be done by the ECB. Whereas for the insurance sector, we are still the supervisor in charge of insurance. So we could eventually go towards having capital requirements based with these exercises. So here we are just in the initial phase. We are looking at the extent to which we can use this kind of approach to accurately measure the risk. And then the issue is also to know whether traditional capital tools are useful to address this kind of risk. So if you look, for instance, at what is already in the Basel framework, there are some dimensions which are missing. For instance, the sectoral aspect is not really factored in the Basel framework. The geographical concentration is not necessarily also factored in this kind of approach. So the question is also whether capital requirements at the individual level are the best tools, or whether you would need more macroprudential approaches, in which case it could be effectively set by the French government, for instance. So there are different responses to this question.
And maybe two questions that you can take jointly is one asking whether the hypothesis on the dynamic of the balance sheet is material for the results. If you work with a static balance sheet or dynamic balance sheet, how do the risk, the quantification differs? And also, are you able to compare your initial results with what the Dutch Central Bank, for example, has also assessed for its own banking sector?
Okay, so the dynamic balance sheet is very important in the context of this exercise. First, because we want the firms to really think about climate change. And one aspect which is important also is that they should be able to, in a way, factor in or reflect their own strategies with respect to climate change. So that is an interesting approach. And given the horizon, it seems more accurate or more appropriate to look at these dynamic balance sheet assumptions rather than relying on the static balance sheet. Static balance sheet would mean that you keep the balance sheet of the structure of the balance sheet of December 2019 fixed, and you assume many shocks and many changes over the 30 next year, with assuming that banks and insurance companies will remain completely passive with respect to that. So this is not really informative. And in addition, because you have a deterioration of the credit portfolio, if you remain static in the end, everything is really in stage three. So you cannot really manage the thing. So whether it is material and it makes a lot of changes. So based on the first round we get from banks, we have seen that there are two strategies. Some of the banks are really playing the game, so taking a management decision and reallocating their credit, for instance, with respect to sectors, implementing their strategies, for instance, of exiting fossil fuel at certain horizons, whereas others have been more passive in a way, and they only replicate the change in the structure of the economy, and their exposures are evolving with respect to the dynamic of the value added of the sector. So you do not see really management actions taking place more than the change in the structure of the economy. So this is perhaps something on which we will need to work later on in order to have meaningful decision, which are also informative for us, but also for firms, in order to use these tools as a management tool risk. Yes.
And then about the comparison between the DNB stress test exercise and the PRA exercise that they have done, which is also...
I think the spirit is quite close. The DNB, the horizon was a five-year horizon. And I think it was also static balance sheet, like the PRA. I think one of the difference in this approach is that the scenarios and the shocks that we are doing are consistent. They may be completely wrong, but at least they are wrongly consistent. Meaning that we have not used the ad hoc shocks at the sectoral level or at the asset price level, which are not really informative for banks and insurance companies. Once again, one of the objectives for them was to better understand the transmission channels. So I think that is something on which we bring value added, at least to the firms. So they see at least consistent development, and they can assess through different sides the impact on their balance sheet, be it on the asset side and for insurance companies also on the liability side.
Thank you very much. If you have some time to answer one last question.
Yes, sure.
So someone is asking, what would be the key takeaway or the challenge that you faced for this exercise, and the advice you could give to other regulators that are trying to develop such stress tests? What would be your key recommendation?
There are several, obviously, and we have not done the postmortem yet. But I think what is key is the preparation of this exercise. In our case, we have been working with the industry for 1 year, and this is particularly important to work with the industry, just to make sure that first, what you are developing is meaningful and useful, rather than working on your own and providing the industry with scenarios that they have not been involved or at least provided you with some feedback. So I think that is very important. In particular, also to design and to develop the kind of assumption that they need to perform this exercise. Now, one challenge obviously is the one of the horizon, because they are not used to work at this long horizon. So here, you can think of refinancing or accompanying a client over a long term, but this is not natural for firms. So this is where there are challenges. And this is particularly the case when you try to factor in market risk, because the market risk, usually portfolios are reassessed within a year or less than a year period. So asking firms to think about the structure of the evolution of their portfolio at the 30-year horizon is really today out of the scope and very difficult to do. So I think these are the kind of challenging. And then obviously there are a lot of issues with respect to the methods, which are very heterogeneous, and the data which are needed to do this exercise. And for us, as you have seen, it required also a lot of work. I would say much more than we initially thought in terms of developing an analytical framework and to move from very high level assumptions to very granular assumption. And what had come, I think, which was interesting is that when we started to discuss with the industry about the level of granularity, they complained a lot by saying that it was really demanding and too far reaching. And after a first round, the last time we discussed with them, they complained about the lack of granularity because they wanted to allocate within a sector, and with this 55 sector level, it's not enough for them to reallocate in some sectors. So that was quite interesting to get from as a feedback. Yeah.
Thank you very much. So this webinar comes to an end. So I will, someone will post the same question as in the beginning on the screen, if you can answer them, and you will find the results of these two polls in the Slack page that I mentioned before. So please go there if you want to analyze if Laurent managed to change people's mind on some of this question. And that being said, I thank you very much, Laurent, for this very interesting presentation that triggered a lot of interest. Given the question that we got. Let me just remind you that the next webinar will be on November 13 at the same hour with Rick van der Ploeg, Professor of Economics at Oxford University, who will speak about climate risks, carbon pricing, and financial policy. Thank you very much for being here, and we see each other in 2 weeks.
Okay, and thank you for your kind invitation and your attention. Thanks a lot.
Come.